Father, we pray, Father, that this word would come forth with clarity and understanding, rightly divided, anointed of you. And Father, we pray that as we settle our hearts and minds, your Spirit would lead us and guide us, direct us. Father, give us revelation. Teach us. Father, reveal your word to us. In Jesus' name, amen. Acts chapter 17 and verse 22, it says, "Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, 'You men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with the inscription, "To an unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worship, to declare I unto you. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and of earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needed anything, seeing he gives to all life and breath to all things. And hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed in the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if haply they may feel after him and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also as your own poets have said, for we are all his offspring. For so much then as we are his offspring, or the offspring of God, we ought not to think of the Godhead as likened unto gold or silver or stone or graven by art in man's devices. In the time of his ignorance God winked at, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he hath appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in that he hath raised him from the dead." Amen. And so here we see Paul, you know, running into some non-believers, heathen, and they're worshiping an unknown God. And he takes the opportunity to tell them about his God. And a couple of things that he did is he's basically saying God created everything. The God that I serve is alive. You can't make a statue out of him. You can't take gold. You can't take anything precious and forge it and worship that. We have someone who's alive, who's living, who's active. So it's not going to be some statue in a corner that you pray to. And he goes, but our God, the God I serve, he created everything. He created man of one blood. He took from Adam, and if you're a Christian, you believe that from Adam came every one of us. And you know, it's hard, people have a hard time thinking or understanding that, but from Adam and Eve came all of humanity. We believe that. Why? Because God has told us that in his word. Amen. And so he goes on to say that he also created the nations. And today I'm going to talk about judgment of the nations, and particularly our nation. I want to talk about that. But the first thing I need you to see is why God has the authority to judge. Why is it his, you know, why is it his duty to judge? Why is it his possession to judge, you know, and then once we understand that, how will he do it? So here we see that Paul says that he, when you look at the word, let's just look at the word. If you look in verse 26, it says, "And hath made of one blood all nations of men for to dwell on the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed in the bounds of their habitation." So when you back up for a minute, it's really saying God owns everything because he created everything. God made it. God breathed life into every human being. Human beings are here because of God. Every single one, whether they believe in him or not, he created them, and therefore he has the ability to set up laws and principles by which he can judge his creation. And then it goes on to say that he formed the nations, which means, and he says three things there. The timing of the nations, but he also determines their boundaries and their habitation, who lives there. So when you look at the earth and you look at how it's forged and what people groups around the world, not only did God create everybody from one man, Adam, but God also created all of the nations and their boundaries and the time of their habitation. Our nation was, the time was, you know, farther in history. When you look at our nation, we're essentially a baby amongst the world. You know, we're young amongst the world because we were founded at a later time. And so, but Paul's thinking here in the Holy Spirit's writing here is basically saying, listen, my God will judge his creation. There's a day appointed when he will call everybody in and he will judge them. Let me just show you how the nations were formed. If you go over to Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11. In verse 6, it says, and the Lord said, behold, this is the time of Babel, when they're building the Tower of Babel. It says, and the Lord said, behold, the people is one, and they have all one language. And this they began to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do. Let us go down and confound their language, that they may not understand one another in speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all of the earth, and they left off the building of the city. Therefore is called the name of it Babel, because the Lord did confound the language of all of the earth, and hence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all of the earth. Amen? And so God took man then, you know, and planted them in different regions of the world. And that's why we have the regions of the world, because God did that. You know, we believe that God did that. The other thing that Paul brings out in Acts chapter 17 is not just that God formed the nations, formed man, then formed the nations where there's clusters of human beings, but in that God would judge them because he owns them, essentially made them and gave them life. But he also says that he's going to judge them righteously. And that's something that we have to understand, that when God does something, he does it according to his own laws and rules and regulations. In fact, when you look over at Romans chapter 3, go over to Romans chapter 3, just one verse, verse 26, it says, declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he, God, might be just and the justifier of him which believes in Jesus. Verse 23 says, actually, if we get a little running start, verse 23 says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace, that's the new birth, through the redemption that is in Jesus Christ, whom God hath set forth as a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare all his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. To declare, I say, that at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus. So here God's saying, his word is saying, listen, he justified us by Jesus Christ. He caused our condemnation, our judgment to pass from us, and we moved into what? Salvation. But he was just in his actions, which means he did it according to his laws and his plans that he had structured for humanity and for his creation. So God just didn't go do something. He did something that was according to righteousness in his eyes, so that nobody could come back and say, you were wrong, you couldn't do this, you can't do this. And so when we look at this, we see that God, in his actions toward us, toward the angels, toward all that he will judge, he will always do it according to his word and his purposes and plans. So the more of his word and purposes and plans we understand, the more we won't get sidetracked by what's coming. Do you understand that? See, because that's the problem. People can paint an image of God. They can paint an image of his laws, his rules, and his regulations. He's going to judge by his word. It's not going to be by what we think, or what we determine. It's going to be only by his word and his purposes and plans. And therefore, you conjure up your lifestyle. You figure out how you're going to live your life and pattern it after the word of God. Amen. I want to look at, when I prayed about this, go to Jeremiah chapter 25. When I prayed about the word, I heard very clearly from the Lord inside to begin in Jeremiah. When I knew what the message was, one of the predominant prophetic words that Jeremiah had was in the judgment of Israel. When Israel was taken into captivity during the Babylonian captivity. And so I want to go there, and I want you to see, I'm going to look at three or four scriptures there, but I want you to see these are God's people. These are people that have a knowledge, a basic knowledge of the Word of God. They should have known better. But I want you to see God's words. I want you to see what the prophet Jeremiah said as an instrument of God to the nation so that we can glean from it how God's thinking. When you look at Jeremiah chapter 25 and verse 5, it says, "They said, turn you again now everyone from his evil way and from the evil of your doings and dwell in the land," that's the nation, "that the Lord hath given unto you and your fathers forever and ever. And go not after other gods and serve them, to worship them, and to provoke me not to anger with the works of your hands." Notice what God is saying. "I will do you no hurt. Yet ye have not hearkened unto me, saith the Lord, that you might provoke me to anger with your works of your hands to your own hurt. Therefore, thus saith the Lord of hosts, because you have not hearkened or heard my words, behold, I will send and take all the families of the north, saith the Lord, and Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant, will bring them against the land and against the inhabitants thereof and against these nations around about, and will utterly destroy them and make them an astonishment and a hissing and a perpetual desolation. Moreover, I will," first person, "I will take from them the voice of mirth, the voice of gladness, the voice of the bridegroom, the voice of the bride, the sound of the millstone, and the light of the candle. And this whole land shall be desolate and an astonishment. These nations shall serve the king of Babylon for 70 years. And it shall come to pass when 70 years are accomplished that I will punish the king of Babylon, that nation, saith the Lord, and for their iniquities in the land of the Chaldeans, and will make it a perpetual desolation. And I will bring upon the land all my words which I have pronounced against it, even all that is written in the book which Jeremiah hath prophesied against the nation." Amen. And so here he's prophesying to the nation. It's Jeremiah. Let's just picture this. He's a prophet in the church. And he's saying, listen, your evil ways, you've lived evilly, you've done evil, you've polluted the land, you've provoked me to anger, you've taken the blessings I've given you, and you've manipulated them for your own lust and your own benefit. You have not hearkened unto my voice. Therefore, I am pronouncing judgment, and my words will be performed. Do you get that? Do you see? That's pretty easy to see, right? And he speaks it out because you've come against me, and because you've come against me, I am going to have to move against you. Okay? And I want you to see that in the Lord's voice, in his voice to Jeremiah, there's almost a tinge of regret there. It's like, I wanted you to listen to me. I wanted you to hearken unto me. I wanted you to live in my word, but you didn't. But you didn't. If you look over at chapter 27, something that I hadn't seen before, but in chapter 27, again, he pronounces it again. In verse 5, he says, this is God speaking, "I have made the earth, the man and the beast that are there upon the ground, by my great power and by my outstretched arm have given it unto whom it seems meet unto me." What is God saying there? Listen, I can do what I want. I'm God. Amen. I made it. I can do with it what I please. "And now have I given all these lands into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, my servant. And the beasts of the field have I given him also to serve him. And all the nations shall serve him and his sons' sons, until the very time of his land come. And then many nations and great kings shall serve themselves of him. And it shall come to pass that the nation and the kingdom which will not serve the same Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, that they will not put their necks under the yoke of the king of Babylon and the nation, I will punish with, says the Lord, with the sword and with the famine and with pestilence, and I have consumed them by his hand. Therefore, hearken not," listen to verse 9, very important, "hearken not ye to your prophets, nor your diviners, nor your dreamers, nor your enchanters, nor your sorcerers, which speak unto you and say, you shall not serve the king of Babylon. For they prophesy a lie unto you to remove you far from your land, and that I should drive you out, and you should perish. But the nations that bring their neck under the yoke of Babylon and serve him, those will I let remain still in their own land, saith the Lord, and they shall till it and dwell therein. And so here, I went here, and I'm going to go to another one in verse 29. But here, not only do we have the judgment, but there's turmoil within the church. Because there are prophets saying, this isn't going to happen. There's no judgment coming. This is ridiculous. And so you have two voices. You have the voice of one speaking the word of the Lord, which is pronouncing judgment. And listen to how his judgment is framed. Jeremiah's judgment is framed because he heard from the Lord, but also Jeremiah's judgment's framed because he could see the actions of the people, and they didn't conform to the word of God. You understand? So he could look at the people, he can look at their doings, and he can look at their actions, he can look at how they were living their lives, and he can look at the word of God and the law that they had, and he can see it was very evident that they weren't doing the word of God. They weren't living the word of God. Now, the 70 years of captivity is very specific, and we're going to move into that point again. I just want to show you, he does it one more time in chapter 29. Go to chapter 29 of Jeremiah. And verse 8. It says, for thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, let not your prophets and your diviners that be in the midst of you deceive you, neither hearken to your dreams, which you have caused to be dreamed, for they prophesy falsely unto you in my name. I have not sent them, saith the Lord. For thus saith the Lord, that after 70 years be accomplished at Babylon, I will visit you and perform my good word toward you in causing you to return to this place. And here we see it again, and I can't be more clear than this. There are so many times that he judged Israel. I could have pulled any one of them. He led me to Jeremiah, and I think it's for two purposes. One is, it's very clear, right? And it's very specific. I want you to see that the judgment of God is very specific. Just so you understand, in fact, go to Daniel chapter 9. If you go over to Daniel chapter 9, we'll see. Just the first three verses. Verse 1, it says, in the first year of Darius, the son of Ahasuerus, of the seed of the Medes, which was made king over the realm of the Chaldeans, in the year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood by the books the number of years whereof the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah the prophet, that he would accomplish 70 years in the desolation of Jerusalem. And I set my face unto the Lord God to seek by prayer and supplication with fasting and sackcloth and ashes. And so, you know, we see a couple of things here. Number one, I really didn't hit it hard, but when God told Jeremiah before they went into the 70 years of captivity, he also told them who was going to deliver them, that the Chaldeans would come in and unseat Nebuchadnezzar, which they did. But here, Daniel, this is very important. Daniel, not because of what the Lord told him, because of the word of God, because he was reading the book of Jeremiah, he was able to discern the time that he was standing in. And because he discerned that it was 70 years, he knew the timing. So he knew the 70-year clock was about up now, because he was taken captive in this. And understand something. God moved to judge a nation, but there were righteous men in that nation that were swept up in the judgment. They paid a price for it. Even though they were righteous, even though their hearts were right, they were swept up in that judgment. And Daniel lived almost his entire life, probably from 14 years on, serving other kings, not in his own land. Because why? He was born at that appointed time. But we see Adrach, Meshach, and Abednego, again, living in tyranny, living oppressed, probably eunuched at that point. Their whole lives changed and altered because the judgment of God came. They were righteous men, and God blessed them in that captivity, but they still were caught in that captivity because of the time period they were in. But Daniel was alert and spiritually sensitive enough to understand the time he was in, and to understand what was going on. And therefore, the Bible says that he set himself to pray for the next step. Now, let me tell you why, because I want to get into specifics. Why they were judged for 70 years. The Word of God told them to have seed time and harvest for 6 years. And in the seventh year, they were supposed to let the land rest. So they would plant and harvest for 6 years. In the 6 years, they would have a double harvest. They would store food product, right? And then the seventh year, they would allow the land to rest. It was a Sabbath. So 70 times, so over 490 years, 70 times the land was supposed to rest, and it didn't rest. It wasn't the only sin of the people, because the Bible tells us that they were doing evil, that evil was being done. But God gave us a revelation here that his judgment was specific. Because they didn't let the land rest for 70 years, God got his way, and the land rested for 70 years. Because basically, he took them all away, put them in Babylon, the land sat and rested for 70 years. So the crime was very specific. The judgment was very specific. They could see, as a group of believers looking back, we can see that God said, I'm going to have my way. My word is going to be performed. You're not going to get in the way of it. You're going to have to pay for it. And therefore, they were taken into captivity and the land rested for 7 years. In other times in scriptures, let me just show you one or two. Go over to Numbers chapter 12. Numbers chapter 12. Numbers chapter 12, very, very specific judgment here on a person. Verse 1, it says, Miriam and Aaron spake against Moses because of the Ethiopian woman of whom he had married. He had married an Ethiopian woman. So Moses married a black woman, okay? And they said, hath the Lord indeed spoken only by Moses? Hath he not spoken by us? And the Lord heard it. Now the man Moses was meek above all the men which were on the face of the earth. The Lord spake suddenly unto Moses, unto Aaron, and unto Miriam, come out ye three unto the tabernacle of the congregation. They three came out. The Lord came down in a pillar of cloud and stood in the midst of the tabernacle and called Aaron and Miriam, and they both came forth. And he said, hear now my words. If there be a prophet among you, I, the Lord, will make myself known unto him in a vision and will speak unto him in a dream. My servant Moses is not so, who is faithful in all of my house. With him I will speak mouth to mouth, literally face to face, even apparently and not in dark speech. And the similitude of the Lord shall he behold. Wherefore were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses? The anger of the Lord was kindled against them, and he departed. And a cloud departed from the tabernacle, and behold, Miriam became white as snow. And Aaron looked upon Miriam, and behold, she was leprous. Okay? So what did they do? They spoke against him because he married a black woman. Well, God said, do you want to be white? I'll make you white. And he struck her with leprosy. What did that do? It made her skin white, right? What was he doing? You want to come against her skin? I'll judge you on her skin. You remember David? Remember David with Bathsheba? He's caught, right, in 2 Samuel. Nathan the prophet exposes him. What's the judgment? The sword will never leave your house. You destroyed a family, so your family's going to pay for it. Your wives will sleep with men before all of Israel. He committed adultery. It was, right? The Bible tells us that Nathan the prophet said, your sins are put away from you. But all of David's life, you read the rest of 2 Samuel, everything he sowed, he reaped. Even though the relationship with the Lord was restored, everything he did, he paid for. You know, we've got our thinking so wrong today in that there's no consequences to actions. I mean, it's exactly what Satan told Adam and Eve. You shall not surely die. There's no consequences to your actions. There's no consequences to what you do. No, what you sow, you will reap. In other words, what you do, you'll be judged for. It's a principle. Even though God told Nathan his sin is put away, he's forgiven. The rest of his life, he had judgment on him and walked in that judgment because of his actions. He destroyed a family, he killed a man, and he paid for it. Do you guys understand that? Do you see that? Well, now, when I pray and look at our nation, and I'm looking at it through my eyes, the eyes of somebody my age and looking at it, and I look at where we've been and where we've come, I've prayed, and there's two or three things that I want to bring to the surface that I have to tell you for an assurity that God is going to judge our land. There is no way he's not going to. The first is, go to Psalm 106, 106 Psalm. Yea, verse 37, it says, yea, they have sacrificed their sons and their daughters unto devils, and shed innocent blood, even the blood of their sons and their daughters, whom they sacrificed unto idols and the Canaanite, and the land was polluted. Notice, the land was polluted with the innocent blood. Thus we were defiled with their own works, and went a-whoring with their own inventions. Therefore was the wrath of the Lord kindled against his people, insomuch as he abhorred their own inheritance. And he gave them into the hand of the heathen, and they were hated. They hated them and ruled over them. Their enemies also oppressed them. They were brought into subjection under their hand. Many times did he deliver them, but they provoked him with their counsel and brought them low in their iniquities. And here, I'm going to tell you that the law of the land allows the innocent slaughter of innocent children in our land. Abortion has killed 60 million babies, most of which would have been brought to full term if nourished and gone to full term, and most of them would have lived productive lives on the earth. But not only is abortion wrong and evil, because who puts life in the womb? What did we learn in the book of Acts? Who gives life? Who gives breath? How does a woman become pregnant? Who developed that? Who invented that? Right? Not only do we do that, but we decide to terminate this life and not even call it life in the womb. And now it's the law of the land. In other words, our government sanctions the ability for us to take children and kill them before their birth without regard to them. And you all know what's happened with Planned Parenthood and the hideous remarks of harvesting baby parts. I mean, these are human beings that God has given life to in the womb. Well, let me tell you, 60 million. We owe God 60 million lives because we've taken 60 million lives. Do you understand? Deuteronomy, I'm not going to go there, but Deuteronomy chapter 19 says the innocent blood will be on the land. On the land. So not only is the sin an individual sin, but it's the sin of the land. It's the law of the land. When you make a law that comes against God, comes against the authority of life, how can you escape judgment? How can you be so prideful as to think that God is not going to make a nation pay? You know, if you do a study in the Civil War, you'll find that almost the like amount of white men died for the amount of black men that we took from Africa. I remember Lou Engle had his thing here. It was almost equal. I mean, it was, you know, give or take a few thousand, where the Civil War cost the North and the South an equal amount of white men for the black men that were uprooted from their families and taken and brought over here for slaves. I mean, think about that tragic time in our history. But how can we continue to kill innocent babies? It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous what we're doing. You know, the other, go over to Romans chapter 1. You know, sin is sin. But when the government of a land sanctions the sin, and the king of the land, who's our president, gets in front and glorifies the sin of the land, our land's in trouble. Our land's in trouble. Go over to Romans chapter 1, verse 21. It says, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, but became vain in their own imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Now, I believe Romans chapter 1 is specifically for us. I mean, it's historical. It's 2,000 years old. But when I read this, no other land or nation has sanctioned gay marriage ever. I mean, we don't have any historical, even in Sodom and Gomorrah, homosexuality was a big thing, but never did they take it and call it marriage like we've done. We've invented something that's even more grievous. When I read this, I can almost see our nation. Because he says here, even though, because when they knew God, in other words, they had a knowledge that there is a God. If you ask people that are for abortion and for gay marriage, they'll tell you, is there a God? Most of them would say yes. Most of them would say there is a God. But they don't glorify him as God. In other words, they don't put him in the position as God, right? They're never thankful to him. They're vain. In other words, their own thinking, their own imaginations, their own hearts are darkened with their own thinking, with the lust of their own thinking. It says, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into the image likened unto corruptible man, birds, four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore, God also gave them up to. I want you to underline that. God gave them up to. Because he says it three times. Uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts to dishonor their own bodies between themselves. Who changed the truth of God, in other words, who changed the word of God into a lie, and worshiped and served the creature more than the creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up to, there it is again, vile affections. For even their women did change the natural use into that which was not natural, or nature, against nature. And likewise, also men, leaving the natural use of a woman, burning in their lusts one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, receiving in themselves that recompense of their error which was meet. And even as they did not retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which were not convenient. Being filled with all unrighteousness and fornication and wickedness and covetousness and maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceitful, malignant, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affection, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death. Not only do they do the same, but they have what? Pleasure in doing them. Okay, so here we have, it's very clear what we're talking about here. I mean, can you see that? It's very clear we're talking about homosexuality. Men burning with men, women leaving the natural use. I mean, it's clear that the sin here is homosexuality. Okay? God said that it was so rampant here that he got out of the way. He gave them over to. In other words, God was there fighting against it, coming against it, and it came to a point where they were so vain in their imaginations, they were so hell-bent on doing this, there was so much pleasure in them doing this, that God said, I'm getting out of the way. If you want to sin, if you want to live this way, then go ahead, have at it. But understand something, I will judge you. And the judgment is death. Now, homosexuality is just like adultery. It's a sin, okay? The difference is we've made it the law of the land again. We've sanctioned it as a nation, and our leadership has glorified it as a way of life. I mean, they painted the White House in the rainbow to glorify the actions of, of, of gay marriage. Now, again, if a pastor in a pulpit was to have an adulterous relationship with the choir director, so his wife sitting on one side and the choir director sitting on the other side, wouldn't it make your skin crawl? Well, people aren't vexed with this. Most of the church is not vexed with homosexual marriage. I mean, most people can't even figure out why we're so upset about it. And because they don't understand the Word of God. When you go over to Mark chapter 10. Go over to Mark chapter 10. In verse 5, it says, "And Jesus answered and said unto them, For the hardness of your heart he wrote this precept. From the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. And for this cause shall a man leave his mother and father, shall cleave to his wife, and the two shall be one flesh, so then they are no longer two or twain, but one. And what God hath joined together, let no man put asunder." So what this tells me is God made them male and female. God created marriage, right? And when you get married, it's God that joins you to your wife or your husband. So if it's God's creation as a male and a female, and marriage is sanctioned by God and invented by God, made by God, and God is the joiner together, how prideful can you be to take that and to change the rules of a nation to accommodate something that's sin? And let me tell you, I am not pulling this out because adultery is the same sin. I mean, it's sin against the Word of God. But we as a nation, and that's what we're talking about here, judgment on our land, we as a nation have framed laws that now allow for gay marriage, now allow for a homosexual lifestyle. How can you not see that God, there'll be some backlash with God here? You have to be foolish, absolutely foolish, not to think that eventually, I can't tell you if it's this year, next year, 10 years from now, or 20 years from now, or 40 years from now, but at some point, we're going to pay for the path we're on if we don't change. And I don't see any changing in sight. In fact, what I see is the opposite. Go over to Psalm 2. The second Psalm. Verse 1, it says, "Why do the heathens rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying." Now it says here that what? The kings of the earth and the rulers take counsel against the Lord himself and his anointed. Who's his anointed? It's us, right? "Let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us." So it's saying here that the leaders, the kings of the earth and the rulers of industry and education and the political structure have taken counsel against the Lord and the Lord's anointed to break their bands. What does that mean? That means to break us up, to break us apart, to break the strength that holds us together, okay? To cause division amongst us, right? And then secondly, to cast us off from them, to make us an outcast to society. Do you guys see that? Do you see that, and when you back up from it, you can now teach things about the Muslim faith in a school, but you can't teach Christianity, right? We're going to have, wait until they see the sex education workbooks next year. They're not in print yet, but next year, there are people that are going to absolutely be mortified by what their kids are learning in school about sex education. Because now it's integrated gay marriage. And so now all of this other stuff that their kids didn't have to deal with, and I think it's going to cause a backlash. I pray it does. Because nobody was thinking it out when they started jumping up and down. But here, do you see this coordinated effort? What is the effort here? To break up Christianity, to grind it down to the ground, to break it apart, to cause it to be less of a force in the earth, to cause the agenda that is anti-Christ or against God and against God's word to flourish in kingdoms and in industry and education and around the world. And you're watching it live on TV every night. And it's happening right on our watch. You know, now when we look at the church today, we have to look. First off, go over to 2 Peter. I want to show you something. 2 Peter. Yeah. Actually, you know what? Go to Revelations first. Revelations 3. Revelation chapter 3 and verse 14. It says, "And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans write these things, saith Amen, the faithful and true witness, the beginning of creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would that thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm, neither cold nor hot, I will spew thee out of my mouth." Now, what is he saying? He's talking to the leadership of the Laodicean church, and he's saying, you're not cold and you're not hot. You're lukewarm. In other words, you have a little bit of cold and you have a little bit of hot, right? You gotta turn both on to get lukewarm, right? So he's saying, because you're not, I wish you were one or the other. I mean, God's saying, if you were cold, you'd be less dangerous. If you were hot, it would be great, right? He said, but because you're in the middle, you're not effective to anybody. You're useless, essentially, is what he's saying. So I spew you out of my mouth is what? A rejection, okay? Because thou says, and this is the heart of a lukewarm person, because thou says, I am rich and increased with goods and have need of nothing, knowest thou that thou art wretched and miserable and poor and blind and naked? So here the human being is saying, because we're comfortable, and let me tell you, let me use my own words, okay? Because we're comfortable and blessed and we're increased with goods and we're living in the blessings of the Lord, because things are so comfortable right now with us, but God's rebuke back was, you're wretched, you're miserable, you're poor spiritually, you're blind spiritually, and you're naked spiritually. That's what he's saying. You see, one is, here's how we're living and how comfortable we are in our nation. And the other one is, you know, here's God's observation. You're so spiritually blind, you can't even see it coming. You're so spiritually desensitized, you don't even know what's going on. You're so naked, you used to be clothed in righteousness when you were hot. Now you're naked. You don't wear the righteousness of God. And therefore, it goes on to say, I counsel of thee, this is Jesus speaking, I counsel thee, buy of me of gold tried in the fire, that thou mayest be rich. What does that mean? The trying of your faith, amen? Working of faith builds what? Riches in heaven. White raiment, what is that? That's righteousness, that thou may be clothed from the shame of thy nakedness. It does not appear. Anoint thy eyes with what? Eye salve, that thou might see what? Spiritually. As many as I love, rebuke, and chasten. Look at what he says. Be zealous, therefore. What's the lukewarm Christian not? He's not zealous. He's not zealous, which means what? And it says repent. What does it mean? It means he's not praying. He's not fighting. He's not vexed. He's not moved by what's going on. And the Lord's telling him, because you're sitting there so comfortable in your lazy boy watching your 550 channels on TV, and you don't know that your nation and the church is disintegrating before you because you're not spiritually sensitive. Now go over to 2 Peter. Verse 6, it says, "And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah." Now, does everyone know Sodom and Gomorrah's sin was homosexuality? It was rampant there. turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemn them with an overflow or overthrow, making them an example unto those that what? That after should live godly. In other words, they're an example of what God will do. And deliver just Lot, listen to what Lot was, vexed with the filthy lifestyle of the wicked, for that righteous man dwelling among them, in seeing and hearing, it vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. You see, I'm talking to people that aren't Bible, they're Christians in their mind, but they don't own a Bible and they don't read a Bible. They're not vexed by what's going on out there. And I have people that own Bibles that say that aren't vexed with what's going on. Lot was vexed with what he's seen and what was going on. Saints, without a fervent, zealous church to fight the darkness coming, the darkness is going to overcome. It's only a matter of time. It's only a matter of time. We are already moving toward the minority. We are already in a place where we're looked down upon, where we're not tolerant. And people are running instead of fighting. Nobody is championing the cause. I mean, I don't see any of the major voices, because there will be a backlash. There will be a backlash to standing up for this stuff. But if we don't stand up now, how far will it go without God moving to try and stop it? Now, I think prayer is vital. Prayer is important. But there's something else I think that's very vital. Go over to Ezekiel chapter 14. I mean, I pray that God puts the brakes on, saints. I pray that he intercedes in a way that's not a judgment to destroy, but a judgment to correct. You know, I pray for that. I pray that he would move, not in anger to upset us, to even take our nation from us. You know, we don't even think that's a possibility. Did you ever think they would take down two towers in New York before they did? You know, so don't leave out any possibility to what might happen if God removes his favor. So, I mean, I'm not trying to, you know, I'm trying to sound an alarm. I'm trying to sound an alarm that we need to pray. And not only pray, but we need to fight this stuff as much as we can. But the scripture here in Ezekiel chapter 14, and I find this interesting, because the three prophets here, let me read it and then we'll go back through it. Ezekiel chapter 14 and verse 12 says, "The word of the Lord came to me again, saying, Son of man, when the land sinned, or the nation sins against me by trespassing grievously, then will I stretch out my hand upon it, and I will break the staff of the bread thereof, and will send famine upon it, and will cut off man and beast from it. Though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they should deliver but their own souls by their righteousness, saith the Lord God. And if noisome beasts to pass through the land, and they spoil it so that it's desolate, and no man might pass through because of the beast, though these three men were in it, as I live, saith the Lord God, they shall deliver neither sons nor daughters. They only shall be delivered, because the land shall be desolate. Or if I bring a sword against the land, say, sword, go through the land, so I cut off man and beast from it. And though these three men were in it, as I live, saith the Lord God, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter, but they only shall be delivered themselves. Or if I send pestilence into the land, and pour out my fury upon it in blood, and cut off from it man and beast, though Noah and Daniel and Job were in it, as I live, saith the Lord, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter, they shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness. For thus saith the Lord God, how much more when I send my four sword judgment upon Jerusalem, the sword and the famine and the noisome beast and the pestilence, to cut off from it man and beast, yet I beheld therein shall be left a remnant that shall be brought forth, both sons and daughters. Behold, they shall come forth unto you, and you shall see their way in their doings, And you shall be comforted concerning the evil which I have brought upon Jerusalem, even concerning all that I have brought upon it. And they shall comfort you, and you shall see their ways and their doings, and you shall know that I have not done without cause all that I have done in it, saith the Lord God. Very interesting scriptures. Now, I want you to see what he's saying here. He's talking about judgment on the land. And he's saying that the judgment is so grievous. And he talks about a fourfold judgment, okay? A sword, which is war, pestilence, which is disease and sickness, noisome beast, which in that time period, between, there were no suburbs. You went from city to city along a road. And you, when you traveled, there was one road in and one road out. You would travel on that road. And the greatest thing to come against you were wild things because you slept out in nature, right? And so he speaks this fourfold judgment, and he says it's going to be so strong, and he uses three prophets, and the three prophets are very interesting. He could have chose anybody. He could have chose Abraham, right? He could have chose David, but he didn't. He didn't. He chose Noah, a man who lived in a time where God executed judgment globally on the face of the earth. Noah lived a part of his life, the last 100 years of his life, preparing for a judgment that would eradicate humanity from the face of the earth. He lived that and preached that for all of that time. So he's seen what we're going to see in the final generation here on the earth, where God globally judges. Okay, Daniel seen God's judgment. He lived on God's judgment to a point where he lived under Antichrist and was forced to make decisions between his faith and the governmental laws, to bow down to the image, remember, or go into the lion's den, remember Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? So Daniel was a type of the saint that would live in tribulation, where the Antichrist would impose laws and rules that would cause him to have to make a decision. Right? And then Job in Revelation chapter 13, the Bible says that Antichrist was given power over the saints to overcome them for 42 months. All three of these men lived as a type of the modern day saint that will go through the end times, where Satan has free reign, where we're all facing global judgment, right? Preaching to the world that's not listening, right? And living under tyranny of our government. All three of these saints. But I want you to see something. It says, because of their righteousness is. It's because of their actions in their life, they are going to have a shield, a protective shield, when this judgment hits. What does it say? It says that they will deliver themselves. Not their families. They'll deliver themselves, right? So when I look at this, And I look at this, and then it goes on. Let me just finish it up. It goes on to say that there'll be a remnant because of all of the chaos. In fact, let's look at it again. It says, verse 22 says, and behold, there shall be left a remnant, and shall be brought forth both sons and daughters. Behold, they shall come forth unto you, and you shall what? See the way, their way. See what? How they live their life, how they act, how they react. See their doings, and you'll be comforted concerning that, what, there's a God behind all of this. That the words that they were speaking are correct. Daniel says it different. He says, those that do know their God will be strong and do exploits, right? Here it says that people will see us, and they'll connect it. They'll connect it together. You said all of this was coming, and it came, and they'll see that we're confident, knowing that God's behind it. Amen? Knowing that this didn't catch our God by surprise, but there's protection, saints, in what? Living your life, serving God righteously every day of your life. Amen? So I cannot tell you when. All I can tell you is the current path we're on, just taking the word of God, seeing what God has done historically, seeing what our nation has, what it's gone from to. I mean, talk about God getting out of the way. When did you ever see an agenda move as fast in the last 10 years as we've seen in the gay agenda? We're only talking about 1 or 2% of our population. We're not talking about, you know, the masses. But we've changed to such a point where when you speak against it, everyone rallies against you, where the only safety is in our numbers. is in our numbers coming together and acting together. And so I encourage you to pray. I encourage you to pray. Pray that God would stop this. And whatever means possible to stop this nation, because I believe this nation was founded by God for a purpose, especially in the end times. And this nation is being taken from us because of this lack of spiritual zeal. I mean, can you look in your churches today and see any men and women that would die for Jesus? Most of them would say, God will forgive me for whatever I do. I can deny him. I can deny the faith. I can live however I want to live. He's going to forgive me. Why? Because most people believe that God won't ever kill somebody. God is not only going to kill somebody, he's going to kill billions of people, and he's going to send them to an eternal judgment. Okay, if that doesn't tell you that God can take the other side of what you perceive to be evil, he's doing it righteously because it's his ability to do. He has set laws and structures in. The first thing he told Adam was, do not partake from this tree. When you do, there will be consequences. You will die spiritually and physically. And what happened? Even though Satan said, you shall not surely die, what happened? He died. He died, and we need salvation today because of it. So I back up and I say, I don't care what anybody says. I'm going to look in the Word of God and see what God will do, see how he does it, and see how I can please him. And not leave it to chance. You don't want to get this wrong. You do not want to get this wrong. So it's only a matter of time, and I pray his mercy on our land. I pray that he would bless our land and continue to bless our land. We still live in the greatest nation in the world. We still send the gospel out to the world. But we can't keep killing kids. We can't keep killing kids as a form of lifestyle because you don't want the baby. I mean, come on. Come on. Anyway, let's bow our heads. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this word today, Lord God. And Father, we pray for our nation. Lord God, we pray, Father, that you would intercede, Father, that you would stop the darkness from coming across the land. Lord God, we pray that by your mighty hand, by your power,